portion of the class, we're going to get into server-side scripting. And before we do that, I think I'm going to take a couple minutes to review and to sort of focus on the difference between client-side scripting and server-side scripting. When you see the word scripting, think programming. I think the difference between scripting and programming meant more years ago than it does now. Scripts were typically little programs. But really, when you look at the stuff that you can do with both client and server-side scripting, they're not little programs. So in a way, you know, it's all programming. What do I mean by programming? It means it has if statements, it has assignment statements, it has loops, it has functions. So all the sort of things that we talked about apply in server-side scripting as well as they do in client-side scripting. There's good news and bad news. The good news is the syntax of PHP, the server-side language that we're going to cover, is real similar to that of JavaScript. In other words, an if statement basically looks the same. A loop basically looks the same. The bad news, if you want to call it bad news, is that what's really different is the way that we refer to stuff on a web page. Because remember, server-side and client-side scripting have two very different purposes. And let's sort of draw my famous diagram to sort of review the purposes of these two scripts. This is our client, who's someone running a web browser connected to the internet. And they are interacting via a web, or via the internet with a web server. Now, typically what happens is the client makes a request of the web server. And we talked about the stuff that a request can contain before, and that's going to become even more important now. The request, at the very least, is going to contain a URL. So if I just go up to the browser and type www.google.com, I'm giving a URL. Or if I type ESPN.com or whatever. The very least, I'm giving that. But there's other stuff that's going to come along too. For example, we're going to give our IP address. That's sort of our unique address on the web so that the server knows where to send the response. We're going to give information about the platform that we're on. What browser are we using? Are we using Firefox or Chrome or Internet Explorer or Edge or Safari? Are we on a Mac versus a PC? Are we on an Android device or an iOS device? All those things come across as part of the request. The IP address, by the way, can also be used to determine the location, or rather the approximate location. Really, you're finding the location of your internet service provider, not your location. Which means that, you know, if we were to look at that from a request made here at LC, we'd get the idea that we're somewhere in the Elyria area. We wouldn't be able to pinpoint it down with GPS accuracy to say that we're here in the business division building. The last thing that we're going to talk about that is relevant is form data. And by form data, I mean anything that you type in onto a form. Alright? So that comes across to a request. The server then processes that request. If it's just a plain, simple web page, it simply retrieves a page and delivers it to the client. But for more extensive pages, like let's say, for example, we do a Google search, the request is going to be processed. What do I mean by processed? I mean that there's not a finished web page out there for any possible Google search that we do. If we search for Asian restaurants, it's going to give us a list of Asian restaurants. It's going to do it dynamically, which means it's going to go in and it's going to accumulate that list right at the time that we request it. Now, it's actually going to take a lot of these factors into play if we did a Google request. So if we went to Google, typed in Asian restaurants, it's use our IP address to determine our location. So it's going to give us restaurants that are close by to us. It's going to give us, based on what we've entered in on the form, in other words, it's going to give us Asian restaurants instead of Italian restaurants or something like that, and so on. Platform might not come into play when you're talking about restaurants, but if I was looking for software, if I was doing a search for, games, you know, depending on the platform that I was on, that could come into play when it yield the results. At any rate, it takes this all that information that comes with the request, and the script goes and sorts out all that information, interacts with the database, and prepares dynamically, fresh on the fly, an HTML page that gets sent back to the client. So, server-side scripting, what are the key points here? The key points are that server-side scripting, at least in the traditional mode that we do server-side scripting, we're going to tweak this a little bit when we talk about AJAX towards the end of the semester. Server-side scripting deals with a request from a client. And what's the request from a client? Well, it's all this stuff. And it uses that request to generate a web page. So server-side scripting is responsible for the creation of web pages. They're created on the fly, and another word for that is that they're dynamic, because if something changes, then the web page results will change, if you're thinking of like a search result. If I type in something different on the form, if someone were to do this search from a different part of the country, if a new Asian restaurant opened tomorrow, and I did the search again, and it's in the Google database now where it wasn't in the day before, I'm going to get different results tomorrow than I would have gotten today. All right? So the page is going to change without anyone changing the script, but just based on external circumstances. So, server-side scripting, in a nutshell, these two things deal with the creation of a web page. What then does client-side scripting do? Client-side scripting gets delivered along with the HTML and is used to give interactivity to a web page. It's used to do quick modifications. To web pages. So for example, mouse over effects. So if you put your mouse on a link, you get a pull down menu appears. Or images swap, or you do a form validation or something like that. All those are dealing with an existing web page. So, client-side scripting deals with web pages. Server-side scripting deals with requests for web pages. Server-side scripting relates to creating a new web page. Client-side scripting deals with changing an existing web page. Now, we've talked about a little bit about the advantages of both. Because the script gets delivered with the HTML, these changes can happen immediately. You don't have to make a trip through the internet to do a mouse over effect or something like that. What are the advantages of server-side scripting? You do a lot more of the heavy lifting on the server. You do a lot more processing that you either can't or for whatever reason you don't want to do on the client. Most notable is interacting with the database. For all sorts of reasons, you wouldn't want to, even if it was feasible, do that on the client side. For security reasons, for resource reasons, for all those reasons, you want control over the database interactions. So that's sort of a more heavy-duty processing than simply making a div appear or disappear. All right. So that's the kind of thing that we do in a server context. Any questions about this? Key things I want to get across. Server-side scripting deals with requests and creates web pages, where client-side scripting deals with changing an existing web page. So that's really the big difference between the two. So the language we're going to use in this class is PHP. All right? So PHP pages are simply a mix of plain old HTML plus PHP code. All right? So a mix of plain old HTML plus PHP code. All right? There's a little more to it than that, but if we're going to summarize what a PHP page is, that's what it is. All right? So, let's look at an example. Now, here's a big difference between client-side and server-side scripting. Client-side scripting is because they deal with existing pages. You just need the ability to view a web page. So all you need to test client-side scripting is a browser. Server-side scripting deals with processing and or creating a brand new web page based on a request by running code on a web server. Therefore, you need web server software, all right, to do this. Now, depending on your platform and your machine, you may already have that set up. If you don't have a web server set up on your machine, then I'm going to suggest what you install, all right, and that is a package called XAMPP, I think. XAMP or XAMPP, I forget. I think it's just one P. And so you install that. And that will install the web server software, and it will also install PHP. All right? Web servers by themselves, they're just responsible for delivering web pages. You need the particular language that, to complete it and make it work. All right. I have a web server installed on my machine, and I'm going to show you how to tell if you have a web server installed on your machine. Easiest way to tell if you have a web server installed on your machine is going up to the address bar of your browser and typing in the word localhost. One word. Localhost. And then hit return. If you see something, your machine has a web server installed. All right. In this particular case, we have Windows IIS installed. Windows IIS is one of the two most popular web servers. The other popular web server is Apache. And Apache is what you get if you install XAMP. There are two P's, I'll be darned. XAMPP. And what that is it's Apache plus a certain database plus PHP and Perl. The database we may or may not use. PHP we're definitely going to use. We're going to use a web server component, which is Apache. And we're not going to use Perl, but Perl is another server-side scripting language. It's pretty straightforward to install this. You can install it for either Windows, Linux, or Mac. I would install it on this machine, except for the fact that because I already have a web server, that would create conflicts, and it would probably break both web servers if I tried to install it on this machine. So I won't do that. But go in and download it, install it if you need a web server, and if you run into difficulties, we can review it. All right. So what do PHP pages look like? Well, let's go in and make a very, very, very simple one. I'm going to go in and I'm not going to do that. I'm going to open up Notepad++. And first of all, anything that you put that you can put in a regular HTML page, you can put in a PHP page. All right. So right off the bat, PHP pages are sort of souped up HTML pages. So anything that's legal in an HTML page is legal in the PHP page. So what are things that are legal in a PHP or an HTML page? Well, for the most part, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. All right. So you can have any mix of HTML, CSS, and JavaScript just as though you were writing the page by hand. All right? The souped up part comes from the fact that we can put PHP commands. Now, we have to tell the web server what is plain HTML and what are PHP commands. And we do that by using a special declaration that sort of separates our web page into HTML land and PHP land. So let's start making a web page. So I'll go in, I'll put my doc type. Doc type is HTML, because even though this is a PHP page, it's making an HTML document to send back to your client. Here's our HTML tag. Got the head tag. Let's go and add that. So I can put any HTML I want to on this page. H1 tag, whatever. All right. This is the declaration that tells the web server that we are in PHP land, not HTML land. Sort of looks like a tag, but it's not a tag. Has a less than sign, question mark, PHP. I left some space because we're going to put some commands in here. And then finally, it ends with a question mark and the greater than bracket. Anything within that, the web server is going to interpret as PHP code and not HTML code. All right. So, I'm going to make a PHP table. All right? I'm going to make a table. And I'm going to do a table of numbers and their squares. In other words, you know, 1 squared is 1, 2 squared is 4, 3 squared is 9, and so on. So I'm going to make that. And I'm going to start out doing it a very brute force way. All right. And then I'm going to try to do a better job with it. So, All right. Couple things to notice right off the bat. This is where I said that the good news and bad news is the good news is that PHP syntax is very similar to the syntax of JavaScript. The bad news is that there are differences. One of the differences is that variables start with a dollar sign. So all your variables start as with a dollar sign. PHP is like JavaScript in the sense that you don't really have to declare your variables. You just start using them. All right, so I don't have any declaration like I might in other languages saying that I is or the n is an integer or anything like that. I just start using my variable. Sometimes people think that's cool. Oh, I could just start using a variable, I don't have to declare it. That could actually be dangerous, all right, if you're not careful. At any rate, this is a basic assignment statement just like you'd have in JavaScript, where I create a variable called n, and I give that variable a value called 1. A value of 1, rather. So what's a variable, again, is a storage location that has a name. So I'm putting in that storage location that's named n, the number 1. The next statement simply takes n, multiplies it by itself, and stores the result in a new variable called s. I then have a print statement, and this is an important statement. A print statement says, send this stuff to the browser. So this is actually making HTML to send to the browser. All right? So none of this stuff gets sent to the browser. This is just a calculation that we're doing. We're sending anything that has a print in front of it, we're sending it to the browser. We're outputting it. You can also use echo instead of print. So if you see an example that says echo, just echo means the same thing as print. And what are we sending? We're sending $n squared is $s. Here's sort of a neat feature of PHP is they have what are called magic quotes. All right? And magic quotes are the double quotes. What's magic about them? Well, wherever a variable is seen within the magic quotes, that is within the double quotes, so whenever we see a dollar sign n, it's not going to display the character's dollar sign n, it's going to display the value of that variable. So in this case, dollar sign n has a value of 1. So this is going to output to the browser, 1 squared is whatever 1 times 1 is, which is also 1. All right. So let's save this, and then, boom, we're back out of PHP, and we're back in HTML land, and we finish up with the HTML. So key things about this. This is the block of PHP code. That block of PHP code can live anywhere within an HTML document. And think of it as writing a web page, but writing it based on a program instead of just hard coding the HTML. So let's go and save this. I'm going to go and save it. And I'll save it on the desktop. And I will call it first.php. All right. So there it is. If I go and I try to open this in a web browser, let me try that. Let me open up Chrome. And I'm going to try opening up this page in a web browser. It didn't work. All right. The web browser understood the parts of the page that are HTML, right? So that was hard coded as an H1 tag, it understood. But that PHP code, that block of PHP, it didn't know what to do with. All right. Why not? Well, because browsers don't understand PHP. Browsers understand HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. Remember, though, PHP creates an HTML page when it's run on a web server. So the first thing I want to illustrate is you can't simply open up a PHP page in a browser. It won't work. What do you have to do instead? You have to run it on a web server. Now, I already established that this machine has a web server. All right, it has Microsoft IIS. So what I have to do is I have to be able to request this from the web server. In order to do that, I have to put it in a folder that the web server knows about. Now, for Microsoft IIS, by default, that folder is the folder C, inetpub, www root. So I'm going to clear out the stuff that's in here today. All right, got rid of it. And I'm going to copy this page in there. Now, on the machines here in here at LC, we don't have. It's warning us that we're doing something that we don't really have permissions to do. And so I'm going to say, yeah, I know. I want to do it anyhow. And boom, there it copied it over. It also won't let me edit it right in place. So I have to edit it somewhere else and copy it over. All right. So now that it's there, I have to request it from a web server. So how do I request it from a web server? I type in the web server's name. In this particular case, my web server is localhost, all right, a slash, and then the name of the page. So what does that mean? Localhost means that I want to run it on this server. I want to run the script called first.php on my server. I'm not running it on Google server or ESPN server or anything like that. I'm running it on mine. That's what the localhost part of that means. First.php is the name of the PHP script that I want to run. And if you notice, I copied first.php into this location. Now, what's special about this location? This is what's called the web server's root. All right, it's sort of the base for which, where all the files that the web server can see start there. All right. It'll be different if you install XAMPP. It'll be a different folder for it. All right. But in this case, we have to put it in the web server's root, which is, in my case, C inetpub www root. So now, when I type that in and run it, I get 1 squared equals 1. Pretty cool. So I could do this again. For 2 squared. Now remember, I'm working on the desktop, and this is something that confuses students, and a lot of times they'll have issues with this because they'll be working on a page in one place and forgetting to copy it over or whatever. So this is a little tricky, so you really have to focus and pay attention. But I'm going to save it on the desktop, then I'm going to copy it again to CINETPUB www root. Replace, and it will complain that I don't have permission, and I will say, go ahead. And now if I do it, I'll get that. Now, here's something that we can do. We can output any HTML we want. So, for example, I could put this in an H2 tag if I wanted to. How do I output HTML? I just include the tag as part of the string that I'm outputting. So I saved it on the desktop again. I'm going to copy it over. and refresh. And now it appears bigger because it's in an H2 tag instead of an H1 tag. Any questions about what we have so far? Key things to remember is PHP has to be processed by a web server, which means, first of all, you have to have a web server installed. All right. How do you know if you have a web server installed? Type in localhost. If you see something that looks like something, then you probably have a web server installed. If you see something that looks like an error, saying, I don't know what localhost is, then you don't have a web server installed. Yes? Absolutely. Absolutely. It's just a different way of writing HTML. All right? You can write the HTML, or you can write code that writes the HTML. But in either case, that code gets sent to the browser as HTML. The browser doesn't know the difference between code that I hand-coded and code that the PHP script generated. So, for example, if I were to look at the source of this page, if I did a view source, all I see is the HTML that got generated. There's nothing here that indicates that this was done via the PHP and this was done otherwise. So the HTML that my PHP script generates is no different than the HTML that I hand code. Okay? Now, when would I ever do something this simple? You know, I might as well hard code this in HTML if all I was going to do is square one number. Well, true. What if I wanted a table of squares of 1 through 100? All right? That would get to be very tedious, plus I'm able to make mistakes, and so on. So what I can do is I can actually use a loop in my PHP to write and to make 100 rows. All right? So, I'm going to go and code this. I'm going to make sure it works because I don't want to lecture about something that has a big error in it that I overlooked. And then I'll go over and explain what I did if it isn't clear. Notice I'm doing the same sort of thing I did in JavaScript. That is, I'm indenting to show sort of what belongs together. that's not good. I'm going to look and see what's wrong with the code. I will talk about PHP debugging in more detail probably next time. Notice how the error message is very nondescriptive. There's a reason for that. When I'm in development mode, I probably want to see detailed error messages, right? Because, I'll talk about that now. When I'm in development mode, I probably want to see detailed error messages so I know exactly what went wrong. But when I'm in production mode, I don't want to give detailed error messages. Why not? Any ideas why I wouldn't want to give detailed error messages? Security, yeah. But if you give detailed error messages, you can potentially give away information that could be used to compromise your site. So you just give very vague error messages. What this just says is, hey, this page doesn't work. So I'm in development mode now, right? So I would want to go in and change a particular file. So I'm going to look for, the file's name is php.ini. And there it is. Now, this file has a whole bunch of settings in it that allow you to configure things. The semicolon is comments, by the way. And if we look here, I'm going to do a search for error. There's a thing says, this directive controls whether or not PHP will output errors. Notice it's set to off. So it's not displaying errors. It's just giving that very vague error. So I'm going to go and I'm going to change it to on. I'm going to save this. And interestingly enough, it's not letting me save it again because of security reasons. So I'm going to save it to the desktop, my PHP any, and then I'm going to copy it over. I can find out where it is. It's in the desktop because I copied it there, of course. Show me all. trick it to showing me the one that I want by renaming this. It's in program files IE Express PHP version. So I can then go and rename this back. Copy it into here. Replace the file. I don't have permission. Yes, I want to do it anyhow. Now, when I go and do this, that gives me an error saying syntax error unexpected plus plus expecting a parenthesis. So let's look at that line. Ah. Problem, of course, is I forgot my dollar signs. I can copy that back over. Now on your machine at home or your laptop, you'll only have to like make that change once to change the PHP any. Okay. So now we go and run this, and boom, there's my page made via PHP that has a nice table of the numbers from 1 through 100. Again, that is something that I probably wouldn't want to do manually, right? Because I'm liable to make a mistake, and if someone came along and said do it to 1,000, you know, it would then be a pain to maintain. All right, what did I do here? First two things are simply outputting some static HTML tags. I could have just as well put these in HTML code. That's one thing about PHP that is kind of interesting. It's flexible, which can make it very unreadable if you're not careful. But if I say print this, I'm simply outputting an HTML tag. So I'm outputting my start table tag. I'm outputting my first table row, which consists of two THs for the number and squared. So all I'm doing is I'm sending the browser HTML. Same thing when I close this. Now, my for loop works like a for loop in JavaScript or really most programming languages. It starts a variable off at this initial value. It does this as long as this condition is true, so as long as n is less than or equal to 100, it does this. Each iteration through the loop is going to increase n by 1. So we'll get 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way up through 100. I do the math and square it, and then I output. Because this line of code is within the loop, it's going to execute once for every trip through the loop. So since the loop is going to execute 100 times, this print's going to execute 100 times. And what am I outputting? I'm outputting a table row. And the table row consists of two table data fields, two TDs. This one which outputs the number, and this one which outputs the number squared. Again, with the magic quote, simply by putting that string in quotes, it substitutes the value of the variable for the variable name. All right, questions about any of this? A good exercise to do would be to see if you can take my example and run it on your machine, either your machine in lab or your laptop. That will make sure that you have a web server installed and that you're ready and prepared to do this, and that you understood the basic concepts of accessing a file through a web server, and so on. Any questions over any of this? What we'll pick up on next time is that, yeah, this is neat to be able to do this, but really, a lot of times PHP is most effectively done when we take and do something with the user input. You know, think of Google, where you do a search, it takes your user input and does a search. Or think of Canvas, when you log in, you supply your username and password, it checks to see if you're a legitimate user and then logs you in. So we'll look at interacting between HTML forms and PHP in our example next time. All right, we'll see you in lab.